All right. Thank you all for coming, and thank you to the organizers for inviting me. So my name is Sumod. I lead a group doing computer vision and machine learning R&D at Solartan Technologies. We are based out of Bangalore itself. So jumping right in. So I think I have this habit of acknowledging certain set of things or places or people. So I think this time's acknowledgement is for libraries that has helped me over the course of FIRID, from IIT Delhi, Clemson, Fremont, and so a bunch of libraries all around, I guess. And you know, this is so taxpayer money, you know, doing a good job here. So I guess, I hope. So, all right. First of all, so what's new about you know, why did this revolution in the first place happen, right? Because neural networks were there from 1980s or so, or, you know, neural networks back propagation was there from 80s onwards, and people were trying out a lot of things in the interim. But we did not get the current, the stellar results that we see now. We did not get them earlier on. So the question is, you know, what happened in the last, you know, 5 years or so, that we are able to get such results? So that's the first question. Now, before that, I think the big picture of this talk itself. So this is more of, I guess, a motivational talk, really, in the sense that I think people, at least, you know, me being part of that community, sometimes we tend to use neural networks or CNNs as black boxes. Sometimes that's okay. I mean, you know, for certain kind of problems, you probably can use it as a black box and you can get away with it. But certain cases, that might not be the case, and you want to understand actually why is it doing the thing it's doing. And if you know why it's doing, then you know how to twiddle it in order to make it do the things that you want it to do, as opposed to it randomly doing something for you. So I think the big picture of this one is, you know, so we sort of want to understand some of the whys, and what are some of the works, you know, some works that have tried to understand some of the whys. And also, how could we make some of these networks more interpretable is another question I'm interested in. And the big picture being, you know, if he asks the whys, then I think it'll be the networks that we train will be a lot more amenable for many, many purposes. And it can possibly take us to much more newer places than we possibly thought we could get into. Now, the second point here I would like to add first is, I'm not a mathematician by training. So, you know, I have envy. So people like Tim and others who are much more knowledgeable in mathematics, if I do say things that are not correct, please correct me. And I'm definitely going into areas which are definitely not my strength. With that disclaimer, I'll start. So convolutional neural networks, you know, some of the things that first of all that happened, right? Why it made a difference. One of the things was that, so first of all, what are these networks, right? They are, So the gist of this whole idea was that, you know, we knew, from 1950s onwards, we knew how, we had some idea of how brains were working, or, you know, we learned that certain neurons, for example, neurons in our eyes are actually sort of edge detectors, okay? So what are edges? You know, you have an image, you have one variation, a color variation from, you know, a dark to white, for example. That is an edge, okay? So neuroscientists are doing experiments on chimpanzees or monkeys, I forget, and cats in some cases. Yeah, cats. They learn that actually these are, they are edge detectors. There are some of them are edge detectors. And then from that, and we also knew that these neurons, you know, there are billions of them in our brain, and they all connect up. And we also, I think over time, we learned that they possibly have a hierarchy to them as well. Okay. So one is we knew that some of these lower layer neurons possibly are edge detectors. And we knew that maybe there's a hierarchy as well, and there are a whole bunch of them. And another thing we knew is that they connect, you know, with what's called as synapses, or they have connections between the between each of the layers. So now the networks itself that we created then, they are what you call biologically plausible, meaning they are not exactly replicating biology, and the way neurons work in brain is extremely complicated, and we know very little about them. Okay. As of now, what we know is that, you know, there is more these models called spiking neuronal models, for example, which are very, very complicated, and we still don't know how to train them. So all that people said is, you know, let's forget the complicated ones. Let's simplify it as much as we can, so that we can reverse engineer the brain. Okay. And so simplification was that, you know, okay, you know what, you've got neurons, you've got connections, and, you know, there's a hierarchy of some sort. Okay. And that was the first initial ideas that people were using with. Now, with that, you know, they got, in the 80s, they got relatively good results. What I mean by that is, you know, you might think that the first autonomous cars happened now. Actually, that's not quite true. You know, you had a very miniaturized version, I mean, miniaturized meaning they are big cars, but they work under very restricted conditions. Okay. So, you know, they had this robot called Alvin at CMU, which could just drive around CMU, but it couldn't handle new roads or a lot of other things. Okay. So they could do certain things, but, you know, after a point, what we learned is that after about, you know, 2 or 3 hidden layers, you cannot train these networks. Okay. And that was the big problem that, you know, people had in the 80s. And there was, we did not know a good way of solving that problem. And what happened in the last couple of years, some of the things, this is my perspective on why have we been able to solve some of the problems. Now let me give a big picture, right? I think most of you know here, but some of the data sets, you know, like the Pascal visual object categorization challenge, Pascal walk, there are about 10,000 plus categories of objects. And the accuracy on, you know, what's called top 5, that is, if you get, if you have an object and you recognize it correctly, and you are in the, you know, what you recognize is in the top 5, you know, so I give an image of a cat, and you say, in the first 5 predictions, you said there's a cat there, then you got it correct. Okay, that's the top 5 recognition. So the top 5, you know, it itself was very, very low, you know, say in 2010 or so, 2011 maybe. And over time, but, you know, I think 2012 maybe this was when AlexNet, the paper came up. And with that, they had substantial improvements. And over time, now I think we have reached almost like, I think 90-95% accuracy on these data sets. And this is unheard of, you know, in computer vision, you never have such huge leaps, you know, suddenly in 2 years' time. So now the things that changed here, one of the things was that what I'm calling is, you know, specialization of layers. So essentially the idea is that, you know, people were looking at various different, I mean, initially you're looking at neurons, and then you just said that, you know, all of them essentially are, you know, they have some sort of activation function, you know, sigmoidal, for example, and you had a bunch of inputs to them, and, you know, you have, and the output comes out of after the activation. And that goes to the next neuron and so on and so forth, right? So, but what they here figured out is, you know, if you specialize these layers, and what some of the names we call is convolutional layer, pooling layer, etc. And some of them have some biological possibility again. So that specialization of layers happened. And for example, convolution, if a set of convolutions along with the pooling stacked up together, actually, experimentally, we figured out that actually it gives good results. Okay, that was one of the things that changed. I'm not going to talk, there are a few things that happened in between which did not continue on, like, you know, layer-wise pre-training, for example, which people don't use so much nowadays. Then there are a few communities like NLP where they use it, but in vision, I think it's lesser nowadays probably. So that's one thing. So, you know, specialization layers is one thing. Second is this this activation function called ReLU, if I have it right here. Okay, so that's first one. And so the activation function that we had was these sigmoidal ones, the blue curve that you see here. And instead the reasoning behind sigmoidal was that, so they wanted the people, you wanted these networks activation function to be nonlinear so that they can be more expressive. That's the term we use. The idea essentially being, you know, if you just stacked up linear layers, all they learn is, you know, linear combinations, which are nothing, not really anything fancy. Just like it's a SVM, just a hierarchical SVM in some sense. So because of which you wanted nonlinearity. And I think there's some good properties of the sigmoid, which people were using sigmoid in the 80s and 90s probably. And so one of the new thing that came up is this ReLU, which essentially is, you know, this red curve here. Now, sure. What is the question? Yeah, it goes way all the way. Oh, even ReLU, is it? Oh, wow. It was. Okay, very interesting. So, Tim is saying that this is exactly as the perceptron from 70s, if I'm right, or 60s maybe, even earlier. 50s or 40s, yeah, okay. So, and then there's a paper by Minsky and all in 70s where they said that perceptrons don't do well, and that was a claim at that point. So I think what happened post which was that, you know, you had the ReLU based activation, which essentially is, you know, you have this nonlinearity. This is one point of nonlinearity. Otherwise, it's a constant and a a linear function. Okay. So, but actually, you know, what they figured out was they actually gave good performance. Now, there are two reasons for why it's giving good performance, or at least we think these are the two reasons why it gives. One is that, so with sigmoidal, one of the problems that you have is that when you stack up too many layers, the gradients that you are propagating actually either they vanish or they explode. So that is either they go to all the way to zero or they go to all the way to one, after which there's no learning that's happening. So what you wanted is these networks to somehow, you know, have more space to learn, you know, even if you had more number of layers, that's one. And second, is something, you know, ReLU really helps because it's a linear function at after a point, right? And the other thing is that also these were very, very inexpensive to compute gradients for, because it's just, you know, you just store a value. That's all what you have to do. And therefore, that was, you know, very, very cheap to do. So what happened now because of those two things together is that you could actually have larger number of layers, and they could still learn with the more number of layers. Okay. And the why can we learn more number of layers? One, because it doesn't explode or vanish. And secondly, it doesn't also, you can further, it also, because you had, this is a very cheap operation, that means the computational cost of stacking layers are not too high either. They're actually quite cheaper relatively. So that is the next difference. The third difference, So the third one was, okay, till that point, many of the machine learning algorithms in general, and particularly for computer vision ones, what we used to do is you had an image, you know, which is a, you know, n by n image. So what you did was you actually made it into a vector. Okay, so you took them one row at a time, and, you know, and stretched it out essentially. Now what happens when you stretch it out? What happens is that your spatial information that you have, right? For example, one pixel being close to another pixel from the next line, for example, that information is lost actually, right? And so now with some of these networks, what they did was they actually used a representation which actually allowed you to put all this together, what's called a tensor representation. Now the idea of tensors are nothing but, you know, they are higher dimensional. So your matrices are, you know, two-dimensional, and they can go, if you extend them to higher dimensions, that's essentially what your tensors are. Now they have their own mathematics related to that, and what you can do with them, and a whole bunch of other things with that. But so when I say tensor representation, all I mean is that, you know, they are they don't really use the mathematics of tensors really, just representing it as tensors. That's all what they're doing. There are a few papers on using the mathematics, but they're still, I think, I'd say, relatively nascent at this point. There are a few interesting works, though. So that's the third thing. The fourth one is, you know, GPUs. just having, you know, much powerful hardware, which can do quite well with numerical computations that we are looking at, definitely help. That's the next major thing. So, and finally, you know, you had availability of these libraries, you know, which essentially had, you know, GPGPU backend and some sort of tensor-based representation frontend, essentially helped you as well. That's the next major difference. So all of this together, you know, gave us much better performance. Okay. So, the next question is, you know, why do you need theory, right? So if you're building a house, you know, let's say you're putting up, you know, a bunch of bricks and you're building a house, you probably don't need a lot of theory, right? But if you're building a skyscraper, for example, you definitely need theory, because only then can you, you know, you understand all the structure of the problem that you have got, and understand where you can, you know, where can you extend things, where can you not extend things, etc. The other thing is, so one important thing to note, however, is, you know, if you're starting in neural networks or any area in general, I would say, you know, take a hacker approach. What I mean by hacker here is slightly different from this hacker. So this hacker is someone who's just experimenting with things, right? Who's experimenting things to understand what is happening, to keep his motivation going. And then, you know, you start off, you're an amateur, you're trying out things, and then you start, you know, mastering things. So if you are someone starting out, you know, one way would have been, you know, you go and learn linear algebra well, you learn statistics well, after that you learn machine learning well, and so on and so forth. That's one evolution. The other would be, you know, you go take one problem, try to solve it, whatever techniques you see, you might use them as black boxes, and you start, you know, you're teasing it apart, saying, okay, I don't understand this part now, how does this work? And you keep on digging deeper into it. So I'm sort of suggesting if you're tackling it for the first time, I'd suggest it's a latter approach, which is, you know, try play with the problem so that your motivation is not destroyed immediately. If you're one of those few people for whom, you know, learning systematically from the basics is something that you are okay with, wonderful. You know, you can take the former approach. So that is one thing. So this talk is sort of saying, you know, this is the part from going from here to here, you know, from journeyman to master kind of an idea. And the other is also that, you know, and initially when you do a lot of experiments, right? So one of the things that, you know, commonly, you know, we hear nowadays in blogs and, you know, by people who are doing Kaggle, for example, etc., is, you know, let's just do, you know, large number of experiments. Let's try out a large number of things. Let's try various different parameters and let's see which algorithm works, which model works the best. And pick that model, right? So that works to a, you know, that is very powerful, okay? Random search is really, really powerful. And that's just the example here. So the gist of it is, you know, let's say if I had to find, you know, where the green curve here and this red curve, yellow curve here, I want to see the peak of both of those in some sense. Okay, I want to find out where the peak of those two happens. So if I were to, you know, if I don't know that, you know, beforehand, only by sampling I'm going to know where actually that exists. So if I did a grid approach, right, I will take a grid and, you know, sample points grid wise, I probably will find out, you know, these points, right? So, and which is not really interesting, okay? Whereas if I randomly searched, I have a slightly better probability, you know, of finding it, you know, finding those some of the interesting peaks, possibly. Okay, some of them are quantization effects, but we won't go into them. But anyways, the big picture is that, you know, randomization does have power. At the same time, you want to use, you know, some amount of care along with your random search, one. And secondly, if you know the theory, and, you know, if you have a history of previous knowledge, you can connect all of them together, and you can do a lot more with that than if you just directly are just purely doing random search. And that's a nice quote by Robert Noyes. The fact that, you know, people who are actually working on things have a much better intuition of, you know, where might this all take you to than people who are sitting out. So anyway, so now. Now coming to deep learning itself, right? Why does theory matter in deep learning? First of all, you know, many a time the image, for example, now I'll be talking largely about, you know, from an image perspective, but many of these are applicable to non-image data, you know, be it speech data or natural language processing data, etc. So one is, you know, the fact that, you know, the dimension that the original data lies in is a very, very high dimensional data, right? Let's, for example, you know, 1,000 by 1,000 pixels, you know, that's about, you know, a 1,000,000 dimensional space that we are looking for some patterns. The number of samples you have, let's say 10,000 samples, they are very, very tiny in this, you know, 1,000,000 dimensional space, okay? So first and foremost, you know, that you cannot really, you know, the amount of data needed for interpolation is way more higher than actually what you might have, you know, when you're doing it. The second is actually, there's a very interesting paper from Google by Christian Sigeri and all. So what they did was that, you know, they took these images and they added minor perturbations to those images. Okay. Now, so this algorithm by default is working well. It's giving you, you know, 95% top 5 categories and error, for example. But after this perturbation, this image almost looks exactly like this previous image, right? Do you all agree here? But The algorithm thinks this is an ostrich with a high confidence. Okay? And that is true for all these images. Okay? With these minor perturbations, even though it looks exactly the same to you, the algorithm thinks it's ostriches with a very high confidence. Okay? Now these were adversarial examples. Okay? You looked at the algorithm and you saw, you know, what are the values I need to change, twiddle in order to make it, you know, give a high confidence for ostrich. But this actually is telling us something very interesting about the algorithm, right? It's telling us that sometimes it might give you things that are completely nonsensical, and you know, and you have to be careful about that, right? So that's another major thing we would like to address. Another is that, you know, you're training your algorithm, and the explosion of parameters and the models and architectures you need to try out, right? And if you just, you know, look up on archive, for example, the number of ideas and papers that have come up in the last, you know, maybe 2 or 3 years is just phenomenal, right? How do you choose which architecture to try out, right? You try out an algorithm by afternoon today, you might have a new architecture already published on archive. So how do you go about that? The next one is, did your algorithm actually converge, or did it get stuck in a saddle point? And other is, you know, you are augmenting data. Now, what kind of data do you need to augment? So what I mean by augmentation here is, let's say I have I'm doing handwritten character recognition. So I have, you know, 5, for example, written. Now, one of the things that you do to make the algorithms do well is to make them augment the data. The idea is that, you know, you stretch them, you share them, you allow, you know, and you maybe and to apply different kind of transformations, which actually you will still consider them as, you know, the same class. But by giving a lot more data, by augmenting them to the, you know, the data set you have, you hope that the algorithm will do better, right? But the question is, what kind of augmentation should you do, right? There are very large number of different augmentations you can do. Which one should you do? The number of layers, right? You can add large number of layers, you know, what should you do there? And there are different kinds of activation functions. You have different kind of optimization algorithms. The choices are way too many, right? And some cases, you know, this is from the TensorFlow playground. I just took a random example here. You know, your errors might be slightly different, meaning in the sense that, you know, the errors you might get with, this is the same data, I just trained 2 different classifiers, and their errors, as you can see, are, you know, slightly off. Now, I don't know whether, you know, if I had, you know, one particular case here, so you can see that, you know, there's a connection here, whereas there's a connection between the blue here, for example, right? So these guys, I might get, you know, very different results between these 2 models. They almost had the same training error and testing error. And now how do I know? I mean, in this particular case, we can visualize it, right? But in the real cases, we probably cannot. Now, how do I know which actually is this case? So all of these complexities are there when you're training a model. And further, you know, even there are further more of them. There are lots of combinations. We don't have all the time in the world. And, you know, real world application. So now, you know, on Kaggle and other, you know, competition forums, one thing is, you know, metrics don't change. You measure your accuracy in one way. But if you are solving a business problem, your metrics keep on changing, because, you know, the person who told you he wants to solve a problem, he has an idea of, you know, what you want to solve. As you go forward, you realize that actually, you know, that problem has slightly changed. I want to change my metric in a slightly different way. Or, for example, let's say I'm going from here to Koramangala. After maybe from here to Koramangala, I take the direction of going south, okay? As I reach Koramangala, maybe after that I have to take, you know, maybe north, south, you know, whatever. You know, I have to go a bunch of different, you know, roads in order to reach there, right? So the initial metrics that you might tell you, you know, to go in one direction might not actually hold well when actually you go much further down the lane as well. That's another thing. And another important thing is, you know, not all errors are the same, or, you know, are equally sensitive. You know, I mean, when you're solving a business problem, not all errors, you know, you care about in the same way. Some kind of errors you might care about them, you know, more importantly, meaning, you know, some errors might have a much bigger ramification. So how do you handle such a thing? And finally, you want some determinism in the system that you're training, right? Meaning after I add lot of, there are so many different, I might have to change the problem slightly differently. And after this moment, now, do I go, you know, do I do the same experiment I did all the way around? I put 6 months to train the model. Now again, I'm going to spend 6 more months because I got a slightly different problem. So all these questions are, you know, open. And so so what we are trying to figure out is, you know, how can we understand the network slightly better? And I'll probably showcase 2 or 3 different results from the academic community to see, you know, how we can probably take these further. So some of the questions are, you know, what are the properties? What are the properties learned by some of these, you know, linear operators? Why do we need hierarchy in the first place? you know, why convolutions and pooling, you know, why introducing nonlinearities, how does learning work, why does learning work, you know, what's the role of sparsity, and can we have more interpretable networks? So I won't answer all of them. I was initially thinking I might, but I think now given the given time, I might go a little faster than expected. So if you want to, you know, I'll be always outside, I'll be available outside for discussions. Jumping in, first of all, the role of hierarchy. So, let me ask this question. So, why do we need hierarchy? It's, you know, 3 o'clock in the afternoon. Maybe a audience question might be a right thing. Okay, the same reason an army needs an hierarchy. Okay, any others? That's a wonderful answer. So, what we really want to capture is you know, interactions between different particles, right? So, if you know, I had d of such elements, and if I had to look at all their interactions, it's possibly d square, right? The total number of interactions. So, and in our case, you know, we have large number of such, you know, variables possibly, right? So, and one thing if you do is that, you know, this is the idea of multi-scale. This is used a lot in physics and other places. And, you know, this is again used a lot in, you know, even machine learning as well. So the whole idea is that, you know, if you have things that are, which are close by, you know, their interactions, you know, you care about them a lot. And things that are far off, you can take the groups and their interactions alone, as opposed to, you know, looking between this guy and that guy, right? So you are looking at the local information as opposed to looking at the global information of things, and that therefore reduces the number of interactions you have, right? And that is one, you know, one perspective to why you use multiscale, which in turn, you know, leads to hierarchy-like structures, right? And hierarchy, you know, gives us good, less number of interactions in some sense. Now, you know, hierarchy has been used a lot in machine learning in general. One is seen in like architectures, you know, all the way from, you know, I think 50s or 40s. And, you know, the another equivalent of that from a probabilistic framework is the Bayesian networks style of things. And there are a few others like the newer scattering networks, etc. So this is another interesting result here. This is, so, you know, now one of the things that we do with SVMs, right, which is, you know, the yesteryear, you know, most successful algorithm, right? So what they were doing is, you know, we have input space, you want to transform the space such that, you know, you can have a linear separator that will then separate them, right? So I have a transformation function here. After this transformation, you know, this separator actually is just a linear separator. So originally it was a nonlinear one. After transformation, it is a linear one. Now the question is, can we learn phi, right? And that has been all of this time, you know, people have been trying to put a lot of effort into understanding, you know, how can we learn this phi. Now the question is, you know, can we use this idea along with hierarchy and put them together, right? So, and that actually was done by, you know, there are two groups actually who've done this recently. One is Anselmi et al. This is from France, and what they are here essentially doing is, you know, you have kernels followed by nonlinearity, and they have a group averaging. Okay, so you learn these kernels, and these kernels are nothing but, you know, they are your normal, the kernels that you learn in your like SVM case, for example. And it's a similar one here where they're doing with, you know, reproducing kernels. And so if you would like to, you can check this out. I think I should keep it a little faster now. Okay, now this is maybe one of the important slides. So the question here is, you know, when we are looking at, when you're looking at data, the question what you're asking is, you know, what is same, right? When I say two things are from the same class, the question is what is same, right? And to do that, as you can see here, you know, I've got the bird here, and I'm just doing a translation here, right? So the translation here, you know, just forget this is, assume this is all, this is all zeros, then, you know, all ones instead. I'll come back to that in a moment. So essentially this is, you know, first is a translation where you're just moving the, translating it. The other one is, you know, where you can do translation and rotation, right? Another kind of transformation I can do is an affine transformation, where I'm stretching the data, where you know you can see this, you know, it becomes a parallelogram, but you know you're stretching it in certain directions, right? And finally, the another kind of transformation I can do is what is called projective transformation. Now, so one of the things that we would like to learn is, you know, can we learn, so the current networks that we learn just as a convolutional network, the only thing that, I mean, one of a simple convolutional, you know, just convolution and pooling layers alone only gives you translation invariance. Okay, they can only learn that you've shifted the images itself. So you'd otherwise you'd augment the data with all other combinations in order for it to learn. So one of the things that, you know, people have tried out is, can we learn, you know, this affine transformation directly? And that is actually, so this is just the, you know, the equation of affine. In the interest of time, I will keep moving. So, and this is essentially what happens in this paper. Okay, this paper by the Google DeepMind team. It's called Spatial Transformer Network. And the idea they essentially came up with is this one module that you insert, which essentially what it does is, your translation that you learned in your neural network actually was across all the max pooling layers that you had, right? Or your average pooling layers across the whole hierarchy of network is how you learned it. Whereas here, what you do is you insert this one module, and that actually learns all the affine transformations directly. Okay, and there are the gist of the idea is that they got a localization network followed by what's called a grid generator, and then finally a sampler. So each time you train the network, you sort of automatically learn this, you know, this affine transformation during your training phase. After that, when you give a new input, your algorithm learns how to automatically do the transformation to make it as though that originally there was no transformation at all. Okay, so if I had an image that is affine transformed, you give a 5 that is stretched up, you, after this network, it'll actually will give you a, you know, proper 5 without any of those effects. Okay, so that is one of the ideas. Now this again, you know, this also has effects, this also has applications in natural language processing as well. Keep moving. Similarly, so you know, all of this, the study of symmetry, so what we are doing essentially here is, you know, we are looking at symmetry. We are looking at, you know, what are important variations and what are unimportant variations. Whatever are unimportant variations, you know, these are symmetries, and you can reduce them, you know, by using modules that can learn, which can understand these properties. And by having these kind of modules, what you do is you can reduce sample complexity, and further, you know, you can generalize many of the algorithms that you already have. Meaning, you know, instead of networks that only have translation, you can have affine, or even much more, you know, more sophisticated ones as well. So this whole area itself is called, you know, group theory in mathematics, which studies symmetry. And that itself, you know, they talk about, you know, various different kind of symmetries and what kind of symmetries, you know, which all classes of symmetries you want to look at, and, you know, what invariants do each of them hold, etc. Now, and there are some few interesting work on that end. Again, Suresh, Venkatasubramanian et al. Hadn't, you know, they were looking at, you know, pre-training, unsupervised training of neural networks, and they found out they are very similar. They are a close approximation to what they call shadow groups. Another one is, you know, Pedro Domingos again. So, keep moving. So another interesting paper was, this is scattering invariant scattering transform by Stefan Mala and all from Ecole Polytechnique. So what they do is that they essentially, instead of having a neural network that we have, they actually decompose them into wavelets, and they have a hierarchy of wavelets with certain extra nonlinear operations in between. Okay. Now, why do you need them? So the whole idea is that, you know, for translation invariants, you want to sort of, you know, do an averaging on top of them, possibly a global averaging. But the moment you do global averaging, you know, you might lose some of the actual important features of the wavelet coefficients itself. So actually, what you do is you keep both the average data and the actual coefficients, and them put together, you get a network, and that's what they call their scattering invariant scattering networks. And so the idea essentially is that, you know, you've got a network or hierarchical network, which essentially are learning wavelets in some sense. Now the two properties that, I mean, the three properties that they have here, one is that, you know, theirs is invariant to translation, They are also invariant to deformations. So if you have a character and let's say you make some local neighborhood changes, like you know you stretch them in a small region, etc. All these things also can be captured by this network much better, and they are so that is one of the works that they did. So this one again they applied it for on the MNIST dataset again, and they were able to get very close to state of art results as well. But they have much more they are much more nicer in the sense that we can explain actually some of the things what's happening. But again, not very easily though. I'll jump once more. Okay. So the last one, how can we make these networks more interpretable? One more other thing that you can do that has been done again from 80s again. One of the idea was that can you use graph algorithms to do that? And the whole idea is that you put you have a machine learning algorithm, you have a deep learning model or CNN algorithm. On top of that, you put a graph algorithm, and you try to learn using this graph as well along with your neural network. So the graphs in some sense store higher level information, and you can pick and choose how they combine the information. So for example, here is a case of where you want to segment a character, and so so what you're doing is you have a segmenter, and then you have a recognition engine, and there's an interpretation graph, and then finally they form the final result. So the whole idea is that you give a lot of different hypotheses of segments, and from each of these segments they try to recognize whether this part actually is a class or not. Now you look for all the possible segments, and from them you try to figure out probably you only want three characters, for example, let's say. Okay, and so let me step back a second. So here what you have is you got three characters, and you want to recognize how to segment and recognize them together. And how can you combine them together is a question they are trying to do. So here is the segmentation part of it, which is as a graph algorithm. You fuse that into the recognition engine, and then finally you go up, and then you feed that into your recognition learn algorithm, and then further again you have another another graph on top of that. So that's another idea that they have suggested. And finally, deformable paths, so Bayes models. These are models essentially, where you want to encode some sort of so you have parts. You can imagine, for example, a human is created of parts, and then these parts can undergo transformations. Like for example, I can stretch my hand, etc. And I want to sort of encode some of the physics of that into my model. Okay, and so they essentially form those as graphs, and then they give edge weights for each of these parts in order to say how they deform. So actually, there's some interesting work on that again, which are that deformable paths actually can be considered as CNNs, or where essentially they reformulate a deformable paths based model as CNN. After which, it's much more easier to actually understand actually what happens in some of them. So the big picture is that so first is your theory matters, especially when you want to solve certain problems in real world where you want to have interpretability is important for you. And we spoke about transformations and invariance. We said that for just a pure convolution and average pooling alone will only give you translation invariance, and that many times is not enough, which because otherwise you have to give lot of augmentation of data. Another is we spoke about spatial transformation networks which can learn affine properties, and we also spoke about scattering networks which has got translation and deformation invariances. And finally, we said, for example, graph algorithms and deformable paths models, how they can actually help you to fuse higher level information into them. And I think at this, I will stop. Questions?
Questions?
You mentioned the invariance of some operators.
Uh-huh.
So, for instance, you'd have some are rotation invariant,
uh-huh.
It's symmetrical in all directions.
Uh-huh.
Is there a use in this for a collection or a more higher dimensional thing being covariant? Like you take the four wavelet
uh-huh.
thing that you showed with this and this and this and this.
Uh-huh, uh-huh.
Those are individually not rotation invariant.
Uh-huh, uh-huh, uh-huh.
But the collection of all of them,
uh-huh.
if you rotate them and rotate the image,
uh-huh.
so to speak, so you have a rotation covariant thing. And a lot of singularity theory and group theory applied to things happening in differential geometry and so on.
Uh-huh.
Use that idea of covariance as well as invariance, and I wonder if there's a use for it here.
Okay, I'm not aware of it. I probably do think offline and back on that. That's interesting. I do want to think about that. Yeah. Any other questions? Somebody.
Yeah, hi. My name is Sudarshan. I'm a novice in a lot of neural network stuff. I wanted to ask you two basic questions. One is, how do you specialize the layers? And somewhere in your presentation, I think you said something about random search and, you know, some smart random search. So what is that? Is it like simulated annealing or something where you are being smart about being random? So tell me something about those two things.
Sure. So first question was, how do you specialize the layers? So I mean, so as of now, the way, I mean, I'm not talking about the way the ones, the ones I spoke about here, they are, you know, specialization of layers. If you're talking, meaning in the sense that, you know, they are doing particular kind of learning is what's happening in them. But if you're talking about how do layers themselves specialize? What you mean by specialization here is that, you know, how do they detect one particular edge, for example? Is that what you mean? It learns by itself. It learns by itself what are the, that's the whole, that's the reason why it's all very interesting, in the sense that it learns by itself. Correct. So, I mean, the problem is that, so, I mean, you know, we want it to learn by itself for certain kind of things, but we also want that, you know, after what it learns is relatively interpretable. Meaning, I want to say that, you know, oh, this is, you know, this is the kind of pattern that is there, so that I can then, you know, disable them or enable them or, you know, whatever it is. But that is something we cannot do. That is very hard to do, meaning we cannot interpret them. And that is the major problem. Uh-huh. Yeah, so I mean, specialization does happen. So the question is that, you know, whether will it get learned automatically, and, you know, the things that are automatically learned, those representations, are they very interpretable is a question. And the second, the part I was talking about is that when you have these networks, you have large number of parameters over which you are tuning on. So one way is that, you know, one of the idea that people have been trying out is, you know, you search, you take a region of interest that you want to look in, and that region you do random sampling, and after you've done that, you localize a small region, you further specialize, you randomly select again in that, you know, narrow region again. So it's like hierarchical random search in some sense, and that's one of the things that people have been trying out. But there are other methods as well. Like, for example, AutoML is one framework for doing that. So where they use probability in order to figure out what are the right parameters itself. So meaning they have frameworks, algorithms that automatically will learn what the right parameters are.
Yeah, hi.
I'm sorry, we're going to have to stop the session. Please take this discussion offline to